안녕하세요, everyone. So I am Masamitsu Honma, Deputy Director General of NIHS. I am an expert of genetic toxicology in Japanese regulation because I was the director of the Division of Genetics and Mutagenesis in NIH before, and still involved in ICH-M7 guideline as an EWG member. It's my great pleasure to talk about the ICH-M7 guideline in the training on the ICH guideline 2021 in Korea. So first of all, I very appreciate the conference organizer to give me this wonderful opportunity. So this is the disclaimer. I am a government employee and regulatory authority in Japan. However, today's my talks are my personal opinion and perspectives. They are not representing the MHLW or NIHS view or politics. So, as you may know, 3 years ago, it was reported that valsartan, which is an anti-high blood pressure drug that contains strong mutagenic carcinogen, N-nitrosodimethylamine, NDMA. The drug substance was manufactured by Fuhai, the pharmaceutical in China, because many pharmaceutical companies in the world used this drug substance for the valsartan. It was recalled worldwide. But since then, the issue of the assessment and control of the pharmaceutical impurity has been attracting attention. So today, I am talking about two topics. First is ICH-M7 guideline, assessment and control of mutagenic impurity in pharmaceutical to limit potential carcinogenic risk. The second is cancer risk of N-nitrosamine compound contained as an impurity in pharmaceutical. So what is a mutagenic impurity? To synthesize a pharmaceutical, we use reactive chemicals, solvents, the catalyst, and other processing aids. As a result of a chemical synthesis or subsequent degradation, low level of impurity resides in pharmaceutical ingredient and drug product. A subset of these impurity may present a potential for mutagenicity and therefore pose an additional safety concern, because some mutagenic chemicals may cause cancer even at the very low level. So I first mentioned the background issue of pharmaceutical impurity. Here's part of the ICH Q3A, Q3B guideline, which are on impurity of new drug substances and new drug product. The guideline indicates that the qualification threshold level depending on the maximal daily dose of the pharmaceutical. For example, if the drug product is taken over 2 grams every day, so we must control the impurity level less than 0.1%. This means that if we can control the impurity level less than 0.15%, we do not have to qualify the safety even if the impurity is a strong mutagenic carcinogen. So in that case, we can intake 2 gram drug product containing the 0.15% impurity. We are exposed to 3 milligram impurity every day. It was corresponding to the 0.06 milligram per kilogram per day if our body weight is 50 kilograms. It is very, very low level. However, NDMA, as you know, it's very strong carcinogen, can cause a liver tumor in 50% of rat by the treatment of the 0.1 milligram per kilogram per day. If the impurity is like NDMA, 0.06 mg/kg/day of impurity must be the strong cancer risk, and we never ignore the risk absolutely. This is the first problem. The second problem is that this Q3 guideline is valid only for the marketed product, but not for drugs during the clinical development. Here is a part of the sentence in the Q3A. This guideline is not intended to apply during the clinical research stage of the development. So as you know, we need a lot of patients and volunteers during a clinical development. They take large amount of unqualified drug. The quality level must be poorer than that of the marketed product. If the unqualified drug contains a mutagenic impurity, it must be the serious concern. So we must appropriately assess the carcinogenic risk for the patient, even during clinical development. Here shows the history of the impurity guideline and guidance. After Q3A and Q3B guidance established, European Medical Agency and US FDA recognized the problem of mutagenic impurity and issued the local guideline concerning mutagenic impurity in 2006 and 2008, respectively. So later, this issue had been discussed in the ICH steering committee as an unsolved global issue during the development of pharmaceutical. The steering committee approved to develop the mutagenic impurity guideline on June 2010. The expert working group was organized and the face-to-face meeting started from Fukuoka on November 2010. At June 2014, ICH M7 guideline was finalized in Minneapolis meeting, and ICH M7 R1 guideline, Division 1 guideline with the addendum was released 2017. So now we are discussing about the Q&A document and the second addendum to develop the ICH M7 R2 guideline. We expect that the R2 guideline will be finalized next June. So here is the ICH M7 guideline. The guideline first issued on June 2014. It's consisting of the 9 sections. Red sections are mainly quality issues, and the blue one are safety issues. I am talking about the safety issue here, and Dr. Komatsu, next speaker, will talk about the quality issue later. Here shows the important safety point of the M7 guideline. For hazard identification, we focus on mutagenic substances which can be detected by Ames test, and we can use a quantitative structure activity relationship for initial assessment of mutagenicity of the impurity. For risk assessment, the lifetime cancer risk caused by mutagenic impurity should be controlled less than 10⁻⁵. The application of a threshold of the toxicology concern, TTC, to control mutagenic impurity. And the risk mitigation, the considering treatment duration and carcinogenic potency of mutagen. So first is the hazard identification. So ICH M7 guideline focused on mutagenic substances that have a potential to directly cause a DNA damage when present at low level, leading to mutation and causing a cancer. So this type of mutating carcinogen is usually detected by a bacterial reverse mutation assay. As you know, it is Ames test. Other type of genotoxicants that are non-mutagenic typically have a threshold mechanism and usually do not pose a carcinogenic risk in human at the level ordinary present as an impurity. However, instead of the Ames test, we are allowed to use QSAR approach for the assessment of mutagenicity of chemicals. So this M7 guideline is the first international guideline addressing the use of the QSAR for evaluating a human health effect. The M7 guideline recommends the use of the two QSAR methods, the expert rule-based and the statistical-based method. The absence of the structure alert from two complementary QSAR methodology is sufficient to conclude that the impurity is no mutagenic concern, and no further testing is recommended. So my current research field is computational toxicology. I am developing a new QSAR or deep learning model for predicting the chemical mutagenicity. At the next time, if possible, I would like to talk about my QSAR research work. So next is a cancer risk assessment. So as you know, that we have two types of carcinogen. First is a mutagenic carcinogen. The second is a non-mutagenic carcinogen. Non-mutagenic carcinogen have a threshold to express the carcinogenicity like other toxic endpoint. It is a NOEL or NOIL. We take a safety factor, for example, 100 times and determine the safety dose. It is a PDE or ADI, the permissible daily exposure or acceptable daily intake. They are the absolute, so safety dose. On the other hand, the mutating compounds are known to have no threshold to express the carcinogenicity. We cannot determine the absolute the safety dose like a PDE or ADI. However, we can calculate virtually safety dose or acceptable intake considering the cancer risk level. The permissible cancer risk level is assumed to be the 10 minus fifths, and the VSD and the AI are calculated by extrapolating from the TD50 value, which is the amount that causes the death by cancer in 50% of animals. Here shows the lifetime risk of cause of death in Japan. As I said, 10 minus fifths is a cancer risk level, acceptable cancer risk level. It is lower than the risk of the death from the natural disaster. Also, in Japan, so considering the 20% of the men and 16% of women die by cancer, the risk of the 10 minus the fifth is considered to be socially acceptable. So not all carcinogens have been tested for the animal cancer study, and the TD50 values are sometimes not available. In this case, TTC can be used. TTC means the threshold of toxicology concern, which was derived from the result of the rodent carcinogenicity study in carcinogenic potency database in United States. The resulting 1.5 microgram per day. That this value assumes that if 10% of unknown chemicals are carcinogen, 99% of them can be controlled by 10 minus the fifth cancer risk. However, so TTC should not be applied to control some strong mutagen carcinogen because the disease chemical can cause a cancer at a very, very low level. Their COC, cohort of concern, includes aflatoxin-like and N-nitroso and alkyl azotic chemical. These classes of chemicals requires compound specific risk assessment and control. So in the ICH-M7 guideline, so we classified impurity into the three classes. Class 4 and class 5 are non-mutagen. They are not targeted for the M7. And controlled by Q3A and Q3B, usual impurity. Class 1 is non-mutagenic carcinogen, which are controlled by VSD or AI. Class 2 is a mutagen, but carcinogenic potency is unknown. They are usually controlled by TTC. Class 3 is a maybe mutagen, but no mutagen data. This is an important class. So here shows the decision tree to classify an impurity according to the ICH-M7 guideline. The clear mutagen carcinogen and clear mutagen, class 1 or class 2, controlled by TTC or AI, and clear non-mutagen, class 4 and class 5, is not the target of the M7. Class 3 is unknown for the mutagenicity. If the impurity level less than TTC, 1.5 microgram per day, we do not have to assess the mutagenicity, regardless of the mutagenicity, because it is very, very low level. But if this level is more than or greater than the TTC, its mutagenicity should be assessed. First initial assessment is QSA. If QSA is negative, it is not a mutagen. It is not the target of M7 guideline. If QSA shows a structural alert, it may be mutagen. In that case, we actually conduct the Ames test. If the Ames test is negative, it is not a mutagen. It is not target of the ICH-M7 guideline. If the positive in the Ames test, it's a serious. It is a Ames mutagen. In that case, we must reduce the impurity, not more than TTC, or clarify its mutagenicity by in vivo gene mutation study. This is a basic assessment and control of mutagenic impurity in M7 guideline. The next, I will talk about the risk mitigation in M7 guideline. M7 guideline is a very strict guideline to ensure the human safety. However, considering the actual operation, it is also proposing the mitigation way. They are less than lifetime TTC and compound specific TTC. I first explained the less than lifetime TTC. The cancer risk of the chemical is usually calculated on the assumption that the chemical will be exposed for the whole life. However, some pharmaceuticals may be taken for a short period, and the mutagenic impurity are also exposed for the short time as well. So mutagenic carcinogenicity is cumulative value and carcinogenity risk depends on the total amount of carcinogen. So the cancer risk can be mitigated depending on the duration of exposure. This idea is Haber's rule. So this means a higher exposure for short duration are equivalent to lower exposure for the longer duration. So assuming the human lifetime is 70 years, if it can be mitigated 7 times, if the duration of the administration is 10 years, and if it is a 1 year, 70 times, and if it is a 1 month, it is a 840 times. It is a mitigation. So considering the uncertainty of the short time exposure, the M7 guideline can mitigate from the 1.5 microgram per day TTC for the lifetime to the values that shown in the shown in the upper table. It depends on the duration of the treatment. This is the LDL TTC. The lower table that shows the total daily intake in the LDL TTC when there were 3 or more mutagenic impurity specified. This LDL TTC can be applied to the clinical development as well. So this table that shows a specific medication scenario for which LDL TTC can be applied. For example, here antidotes. So usually the emergency procedure can be taken 1 month. And prophylactic flu drug can take 1 year TTC. And HIV drug was originally at 10 year TTC level. However, we have discussed about this scenario in M7EWG recently and decided the HIV drug move to the more than 10 years to the lifetime because of the advance of the clinical treatment of the HIV disease. HIV patient can survive more than 10 years recently. So we changed this scenario in M7R2 text. So next is the compound specific TTC for risk mitigation. So earlier, I said that the strong carcinogen, the COC, required stricter control. On the contrary, so there are the weak mutagenic carcinogen. This is a cohort of less concern, the COLC, including the monofunctional alkyl chloride. Monofunctional alkyl chloride is a mutagen, but the carcinogenicity is not so strong. So for this mutagenic impurity TTC, so 50 microgram per day, which is 10 times higher, is allowed. This is mentioned in the note 5 of the M7 guideline. So note 4 also states that the compound specific AI can also be derived from the published recommendation value from the internationally recognized body such as WHO and IPCS. In this case, it is still recommended to use the lifetime cancer risk level for 10⁵, and it is important to be based on the most current and scientifically supported data and or methodology. However, the calculated AI must depend on the selected data. So there is a concern that this will lead to the different AI value among company and cause confusion. So therefore, the pharmaceutical company requested to set a common AI value for chemical mutagen that may be frequently detected as an impurity. So we decided to develop an addendum. In 2017, we revised the M7 guideline, supplementing the addendum, which includes compound-specific AI, or PDE, of the 14 chemicals. These chemicals are frequently detected as impurity in pharmaceutical. So this table shows AI of 10 mutagenic carcinogens. So they are calculated usually from the TD50 linear extrapolation. So most of them are greater than genetic TTC level 1.5. So pharmaceutical company can use this value to control this impurity. They cannot use the genetic TTC value 1.5. So it by the mitigation. The compound specific AIs in the addendum calculated not only from the TD50 linear extrapolation, but also another way. One example is hydrogen peroxide. As you know, it is a genotoxic compound, but it naturally generates from our body. Its level is 1.55 grams per day. So therefore, it was considered inappropriate to calculate AI based on the carcinogenicity test data. So we allowed 68 milligrams per day, which is 1% of the estimated endogenous production. It is a PDE for the hydrogen peroxide. However, so this value usually exceeded the limit based on the quality of the drug. The quality of the drug's upper limit is 0.5%. So therefore, the PDE is 68 milligram or 0.5%, which is lower. It is the case of the hydrogen peroxide. And from 2018, the M7EWG started to develop the next revision, which includes the Q&A document and second addendum. The Q&A document is now at step 3 after public comment. We are now revising the Q&A document to reflect the public comments. The second addendum includes 7 compounds. It's now under public comment all over the world. These AI were basically calculated from TD50 by linear extrapolation, similar to the addendum 1. But someone calculated by another way. So, one of the examples is acetaldehyde. Acetaldehyde is also mutagenic carcinogen. As you know, however, it is a metabolite of ethanol. So we usually consume acetaldehyde up to the 40 milligrams per day, primarily due to the alcohol beverage, beer, wine, the spirits, Japanese sake. So exogenous exposure from food average about 2 grams per day, considering the non-linear dose response to the carcinogenicity and the weight of evidence on the high background exposure from a wide variety of food, we determined the PDE of acetaldehyde, 2 milligrams per day. It is an oral route. So we also calculated AI for the acetaldehyde by other route. The two carcinogenicity studies of acetaldehyde by inhalation has been reported. We calculated AI of acetaldehyde from the TD50 value in reference 24. Here is a TD50 value by linear extrapolation. It is 185 microgram per day for all other routes. This is the AI for the acetaldehyde for all other routes. So here is a part of the Q&A document of M7R2. So I cannot explain the detail of the Q&A document today. An example, if an AIMS positive impurity is subsequently tested in an appropriate in vivo assay and the results are clearly negative, in that are sufficient to demonstrate of the lack of in vivo relevance, it means that is it a non-mutagen? The answer is yes. So it can be classified to the class 5 because it is a negative in vivo gene mutation assay. The result of the in vivo gene mutation assay take precedence over the AIMS test result. So this is the latest work plan of M7EWG. The Q&A document and second addendum is under step 3. We are currently holding a web meeting once a month to revise the guideline. So we expect that the M7, the R2 guideline will be finalized at June the next year. So here shows a EWG member of ICH-M7. The total is 28 people from the 15 regions or organization are participating in M7 EWG. So it's a big party because the safety expert and the quality expert meet together. So this is a group photo at the Charlotte meeting in the 2018. So in that time, I took a reporter here. And now the Dr. Roland Fossel in EC and is a reporter. From Korea, Ms. Jin Yongnam in MFDS is an EWG member of MSEP. So, next topic. So next, I will talk about the topic of the cancer risk of N-nitrosamine compound. So N-nitrosamine compound is a strong mutagenic carcinogen. It is a COC. So at the beginning of my talk, I talked about the valsartan issue occurred 3 years ago. The drug contained a strong mutagen carcinogen, NDMA, as an impurity. The drug substance was manufactured by Fuhai Pharmaceutical Company in China. So because many companies in the world use this drug substance, so valsartan was recalled worldwide. So in Japan as well, MHW announced the recall of the drug on July 2018. So it was thought that the cause of the impurity was the method of synthesis of the valsartan. DMF and nitrite are used to the synthesis to the tetrazole ring. So dimethylamine, so which is a decomposition of the DMF, react with nitrite to generate NDMA, the dealing synthesis. This is a new method to synthesize a tetrazole. But it sometimes causes nitrosamine, but as a byproduct. So later the FDA announced that the NDEA, N-nitroso-diethylamine, was also contained the valsartan as an impurity. It is September 2018. And 2 years ago, so it was discovered that some of the H2 blocker, danitichin, also contained either xanthan or ranitidine, also contained NDMA, and MHLW announced a recall of the drug on October in 2019. So NDMA was thought to be generated by the partial degradation of the ranitidine. Here and degraded and synthesized NDMA. So it is possible to prevent the generation of NDMA by improving packaging or storage. At April last year, MHW also announced the recall of the metformin. It is an anti-diabetes drug. So because some of this drug contained the low level of NMDA. However, the cause of contamination of NMDA has not been clear. So it is possible that the substance contained in the printing ink of the PTP aluminum foil react with the raw material that remained slightly in the metformin in the tablet to produce NMDA. Very, very interesting case. So NDMA and NDEA are strong mutagenic carcinogen, which are the COC compound. Their rodent carcinogen study have been conducted and the TD50 value are estimated. So acceptable intake can be calculated based on the 10⁵5th lifetime cancer risk level. They are 0.0959 microgram per day and 0.0265 microgram per day, respectively. As you know, this is much lower than the generic DC level, 1.5 microgram per day. In 2019, the cases have been reported in which nitrosamine compound other than NDMA, NDEA, NDBA, NIIPA, NDIPA, NMBA are detected as pharmaceutical impurity. In some cases, mutagenicity and carcinogenicity are not clear, so the safety assessment is very difficult. So very recently, as you may know, Varenicli, the trade name Chantix or Champix, was recalled worldwide, which is a medication used for the smoking cessation, because this drug contained N-nitrosovareclinin as impurity. I think that this nitrosamine impurity problem will continue. So every year we meet this problem. So FDA and EMA released the guidance and Q&A for the control of nitrosamine impurity in human drug at the beginning of this year, respectively. They suggested the AI limit for several nitrosamine compounds in human drug product and requested the inspection and assessment for all drug product. So pharmaceutical companies should work with their contract manufacturers to take the step recommended in this guidance. So in Japan, the last month, so MHLW, so also instructed the pharmaceutical company to conduct a voluntary inspection regarding the risk of the contamination of the pharmaceutical with nitrosamine, which are strong mutagen carcinogen as soon as possible. The target includes almost all drugs with high risk of contamination. The inspection will be conducted April 30, 2023, and for the item that have been confirmed to contain more than the limit value, MHLW requested to take measures such as changing the manufacturing the method by October 31, 2024. So further information, please visit the website here. So this is a summary of my today's talk. So if mutagenicity is found in the pharmaceutical impurity, the strict control is required. So mutagenicity of impurity is assessed by the QSA, Ames test, and the in vivo gene mutation assay. So if negative results are obtained in higher assessment, the strict control is not necessary. As I said before, the in vivo gene mutation assay is precedes over the QSA and Ames test. The mutagenic impurity that has not been tested for the calcium density should be controlled by TTC, a generic AI level. It is a 1.5 microgram per day, which is corresponding to a lifetime cancer risk level of 10 minus 100,000, it's a 10 minus fifths. The TTC level can be mitigated by the duration of the exposure and the characteristics of the mutagenic substances. I said it is a LTL TTC and the compound-specific TTC. And N-nitrosamine compound are extremely strong carcinogen. It is a COC class and require the stricter control. The ICH guideline is originally intended for the new pharmaceutical, but the ICH M7 guideline will be applied to generic drug in the near future from the viewpoint, ensuring the quality and safety. Thank you for attention. 감사합니다.
네. Thank you very much, Dr. Honma. Would I like to have the Q&A session on this presentation. If you have questions, please raise your hand, and the online participants can upload your questions in the open chatting room. Let me accommodate the questions from the on-site participants first. And if you have any questions, please raise your hand. There is no question from the on-site participants, so let me move to the questions from the online participants. There are two questions. One is, in Japan, whether the M7 guideline is applicable to only the new drugs, or is it required for the M7 data submission for the existing compounds when it is a part of the NDA? And is it really also applicable to OTC drug? And another question is that option 4 can be applicable to the class 1 impurities.
So first question, very important. So I think that the ICH M7 guideline applied to the older drug, including the generic drug, in United States and the European country. So in Japan, so the ICH guideline is valid for the new drug. But this is a safety issue. The safety issue should be considered the generic drug as well as a new drug. So Japanese government to apply the ICH M7 guideline to all of the pharmaceutical if the cancer risk by contamination can be concerned. So maybe that 3 or 2 years later, the ICH M7 guideline will be supplemented in the pharmacopoeia in Japan. The second question is, I don't remember the second question, is option 2 or something like that.
네. 다시 한번 말씀드리겠습니다.
Yes, let me ask again. Class 1, is it possible to manage class 1 as management option 4, the approach option 4?
Class 1. You said the class 1 can be controlled by the...
Yes. Can we manage class 1 with option 4? Is it possible?
Option 4 means, I think that this issue will be talked by the Dr. Komatsu, next speaker. That you should ask him.
Thank you very much. Final question. Do we need to have nitrosamine-related data for submission?
As you know, the nitrosamine compound is a very strong mutagenic carcinogen. So usually it should not be detected. It depends on the detection limit by analyzer. So you know I said that the AI of the nitrosamine level is very, very low level. I'm not sure that we can measure the impurity in the pharmaceutical by analytical method. But hopefully, so I think that it should not be detected. It must be the less than detection limit.
Thank you very much.
There are more questions, but because of the time constraint, we are not able to answer all the questions now. So the questions uploaded will be responded on the website. So the answers will be on the website later on. Once again, we appreciate Dr. Hoon Ma for your presentation. Thank you.